Hello and welcome to India's World. Since 2013, more than 30 people have been murdered in Bangladesh. Over time, the pattern of the killings has changed. Earlier, only liberals, atheists and bloggers were murdered. Now the killings have spread to the religious and sexual minorities also. Bangladesh's Shia and Ahmadi Muslim minorities, Hindu and Christian converts, Buddhists as well as foreigners and aid workers have been targeted in the last 1 year. The geographical spread of the killings is also expanding. Earlier, the attacks were mostly confined to the rural areas. However, the murder of two gay activists recently took place in the heart of the capital, Dhaka. In all cases, groups claiming to be affiliated to the Islamic State or Al-Qaeda have taken responsibility for the killings. However, local police authorities deny the presence of the Islamic State or Al-Qaeda in Bangladesh and attribute the murders to local, homegrown militants. To discuss the growth of extremist violence in Bangladesh and its regional consequences, we have with us three distinguished experts. We have with us Ambassador Pinak Ranjan Chakravarty. He's been India's ambassador to Thailand and High Commissioner to Bangladesh. Ambassador Rajeet Mitta. He was India's ambassador to the Philippines and High Commissioner to Bangladesh. And we have with us Mr. Seshadri Chari, an eminent journalist and commentator. He's executive director of the Forum for Strategic and Security Studies and chief of BJP's Foreign Affairs Cell. He's also part of a crucial Track 2 dialogue with Bangladesh. I welcome you, gentlemen, to this discussion. Pinak, let me begin with you. Why has extremist violence gone up in Bangladesh since 2013? And why, despite the government's promise of swift action and thousands of people being arrested, these killings haven't stopped? Not only have they not stopped, they seem to have gathered momentum.
I think one reason is that the Islamist fringe, or the even, why the fringe, even the Jamaat-e-Islami, which is a mainstream kind of Islamic group and was a party till some time back, has been under a lot of stress and pressure. As you know, the JEI leadership has been tried for war crimes, and rightly so, I think, and many of them have been executed. That has certainly created a lot of, a bit of a backlash among the Islamists. But what I feel is happening is not really the Jamaat, which is more mainstream, but these are those earlier fringe groups which were banned by the earlier governments, like the JMB, the JMJB, the Hujib, the Ansarul Bangla team, and the Ansarul Islam. These are some of these names, but names keep changing, but the groups are the same. These are those Afghan veterans and others who, and some may have gone off to IS, but I don't think IS, etc., have too much of a...
We're going to come to that. Ambassador Mitra, do you think that there are two parallel trends in these killings? One, the murder of bloggers and atheists, for and secular intellectuals, for propagating their views, who are seen as enemies of organized religion and Islam. So they're being punished for what they did or what they were doing. And the second set of killings is of minorities, whether they're religious minorities, sexual minorities, foreigners and aid workers, not for what they're doing, but for what they represent.
I mean, attacks on minorities has been going on in Bangladesh for many years, and they are well documented, particularly in the time of the military rulers. But the pattern then was slightly different in my view. It was more related to land grabbing. There was a forced conversion of young women. They were abducted and forcibly converted. There was some desecration of temples and idols. And today it is a much more individual targeted. And anybody who is speaking against the radical Islamic ideology in any form, whether it's a blogger or practicing something which is different, they are being individually targeted. And it is, to that extent, much more difficult to stamp
out. My question really was leading to whether there are two different groups which are targeting these people. Bloggers are being targeted by a particular kind of group, which has been identified by Bangladeshi police as Ansarul Islam, mm-hmm. earlier known as Ansarullah Bangladesh team. Yeah. And the minorities are being attacked by this Jamaatul Mujahideen Bangladesh.
I don't think it's so clear as yet. I think there all these fringe elements are linked in one respect or the other. Their names keep changing, but the personnel are more or less the same. So it's a concerted effort to tackle, to hit both sides, as you
Except that one team, the Ansarul Islam, says that it's affiliated to Islamic State, and Jamaatul Mujahideen Bangladesh says they're affiliated to Al-Qaeda.
Well, even Ansar, as somebody has said, that they have links with Al-Qaeda in Yemen. So these linkages are not very clear as yet.
Seshadri, do you think the The second set of killings, which, you know, that is killing of minorities, etc., which Bangladeshi authorities say is being done by JMB, Jamaatul Mujahideen Bangladesh. Do you think they were emboldened by the government's clear-cut response, unequivocal response to first set of killings, that is killing of bloggers? Because you would remember Sheikh Hasina made ambiguous statements saying that the government was not in favor of those who speak against religion. So if a government that claims to be secular starts saying that you're not free to critically examine religion, then what kind of signal does it send?
No, I think the government has not handled it properly right from the beginning. But I would carry forward this issue a little further. The atrocities on minorities is not new in Bangladesh. What we saw in 71 was a huge atrocities committed on linguistic minority, or probably a linguistic majority, but from a different state perspective. So it was Urdu versus Bangla and so many other things. But even before that, from 71 onwards, the treatment of minorities was very different even under Mujib. One of the most monumental book on the treatment of minorities in Bangladesh was published during Mujib's time. So it's not just Hindus, Buddhists. A large amount of Buddhists have been totally wiped out of Bangladesh history. Today you don't find any Buddhist in Bangladesh.
That's not true. In Chittagong Hill tracks, there are any number of Buddhists.
You know, they are on the periphery to a very large extent, and they are seen as not those people who are in the mainstream. And Buddhism is more of a political nature in Chittagong Hill track. But if you go to Dhaka or Chittagong, you don't really find that kind of Buddhism still existing. Christians, a large number of them are gone. Today you have to just look for them like looking for a needle in a haystack. Hindus are the ones who are left, but they are also now under serious threat.
Okay.
Even before singling out Hindus in general, there was a lot of atrocities on organizations like Ramakrishna Mission in Dhaka itself. So if you look at this, there is a pattern. The pattern is a gradual radicalization of the society and the introduction of Wahhabi and Salafi Muslim.
But is it happening independently of the government? That's what I'm asking you. Does the government's attitude influence these people?
No, it's happening independent of the government. But the government seems to probably not having any clue as to how to go about and act. Because the government feels two way. One, if you take a very strong action, there may be a recoil of all that. And then it could have a political fallout. And that political fallout could probably benefit the other political parties. That one fear is lurking in the mind of the present government.
Okay.
The second thing is, if you are slow and slack on this issue, that again is used by the other political formulations to target the government and say that the minorities are not safe. Okay. So it's a catch-22 situation for the present government.
Okay, we need to take a break at this point. We'll be back again in a bit. Stay with us. Don't go away. Welcome back. We're discussing the growth of Islamic extremism in Bangladesh and its possible regional consequences. Pinak, why is it that none of the local killings have been claimed by any local group? Why have they not made any demands? Why have they not served any ultimatums? Why have they not explained their killing? Why have they not said why these killings are random in nature? How credible are these claims that these killings are done by either Al-Qaeda or Islamic State, you know, groups that are based far, far away from Bangladesh and would have operational difficulty in conducting these killings in Bangladesh?
A very good point, actually. Al-Qaeda and IS, in my view, are simply firewalls, or you can call them camouflage. The ultimate action is being taken by local, and with the help of some outsiders, and I will not exclude Pakistan among them. Pakistan has suffered a lot in terms of its credibility and its support base in Bangladesh because of the decimation of the leadership of the JEI, which has faithfully followed Pakistan's instructions over the years. There are other also Islamic groups. They have their own contacts with the Jaish and the LET and others. But the Jamaat being the is the most important group. There are other elements, and I think Pakistan also uses it as a camouflage. If you can blame the IS and the Al-Qaeda, then ISI cannot be blamed. You know, that is one of the reasons I believe that this is, of course, ultimately this is to create fear, to discredit the Hasina government, and generally to create political instability.
Okay. Mr. Mitter, you know, what are the reasons that are fueling this extremism? Do you think that Bangladesh's domestic politics is also a factor in the growth of extremism? Some Bangladeshis claim that if you keep pushing the legitimate opposition, which is never going to agree with you, by definition they're the opposition, and you keep pushing them into a corner, then the militants can go and tell people that, look, a large section of you are never going to have any share in this politics, and therefore they create fertile grounds for people to listen to them and be sympathetic to them.
Well, one angle is that the opposition is totally out of power without any voice. But if you look back, they are in many ways themselves to blame, because they are the ones who boycotted the election. So the BNP and the Jamaat did not participate in the election. Even though the BNP at that stage was in a fairly strong position, they had won, if you remember, five of the big municipalities just before the general election of 2014. So one is that political exclusion. The other is, of course, the war crimes trial and the concerted effort by the Hasina government to crack down on Islamic radicalism and radicalism of all sorts. And I think on this, she has been quite sort of very determined. And I can name many steps that she has taken to shore up pluralism, secularism in Bangladesh. And that, I think, still remains a major point of her policies.
Okay. Seshadri, do you agree with him? Does shrinking democratic space create an environment where radical elements find sympathetic ears? Or do you think even if Bangladesh were a normal democracy, where there was free debate and discussion was possible, criticism of the government was possible, press was not being muzzled, judiciary was free, and there was civil society oversight also of extremist ideologies, then things would have been different?
I think there is some truth in this saying that the way the present government is functioning is more or less isolating the legitimate opposition, the BNP party, by pushing them to the wall, saying that they are part and parcel of the Jamaat ideology because they had a political understanding with Jamaat. Now, Jamaat is banned, so they say it's naturally the Jamaat lock, stock and barrel, the cadre has moved over to BNP. So the ground reality is, we do not know what the ground reality is. But what happens is, when you take a strong measure against the radical Islam, for good or for bad, you are isolated. The present government and the present prime minister, more than that, looks very isolated. So it's not in the interest of even the government to do the kind of marginalization that they are doing. That's one aspect of it.
Marginalizing themselves, you mean?
Marginalizing the legitimate opposition, the BNP.
Okay.
So by blaming that BNP is part of Jamaat and all these things, they have themselves created a void. So this becomes very handy for those who are opposed to the kind of repression that is taking place. But if you look at it, there is a pattern as far as these gruesome killings are concerned. I would also like to point out, you asked about this, why the local units or local organizations are not claiming
responsibility.
See, one reason could be they don't want to claim responsibility so that they are able to link themselves with international organizations and gain more credibility among those organizations. So this fact will have to be understood by the present government.
All right. Pinak, quickly, while Jamaat was behind political violence in the wake of the war crimes tribunal verdicts of February 2013, is there any evidence today that conclusively proves that Jamaat is still involved as an organization in these attacks? And because that's what is being suggested by the ruling party currently. But shouldn't counterterrorism and national security always be above partisan blame game?
You see, earlier the Jamaat came on the streets, the BNP came on the streets.
Yeah, I'm saying that.
That is
but
gone.
I'm saying now, is there any evidence that they're involved in the killings of Buddhist monks and Hindu priests and bloggers?
The Jamaat is the mainstream. No, certainly. I don't believe that mainstream Jamaat would be involved in it. But I think the fringe groups are involved. And they may be ex-Jamaatis. Usually what Jamaat usually does, when it does these things, they use people who are maybe ex-Jamaatis, but who have their own organization, like Ansarul Bangla, etc., to build again a firewall between themselves, because Jamaat wants to remain mainstream. They don't want this charges to come against them. And I am convinced that these, of course, suddenly these things don't happen. I mean, there is a plan behind it, and these targeted killings are certainly planned.
So I'm saying the government's plan to counter this kind of terrorism must take all political parties together. That would be Bangladesh's national interest.
You see, the problem is politics is so polarized in Bangladesh, they can't even sit and talk together. This is the problem in Bangladesh. I don't think they can even sit and talk together. So that is why there cannot be a bipartisan approach to this, because everybody is continuously going to blame each other. And the government will have to take some action, as indeed they have done. Some crackdowns, etc., have taken place.
Well, it's not a focused crackdown.
It's not a focused crackdown.
There's thousands of people, and then say only 37 people are actually.
Then they will sieve them out and capture some few, etc.
I doubt if there is any intelligence sharing with even India on these counts.
We're going to discuss that, Seshadri, in a bit. We need to take a break at this point. We'll be back again with you shortly. Stay with us. Don't go away. Welcome back. We're discussing the growth of Islamic extremism in Bangladesh and its consequences. Ambassador Mitter, do you think the brutality of these series of killings has pushed Bangladesh towards conservatism and religious monoculturalism? Is there a threat of that kind?
I think it's still, one can't jump to that conclusion as yet. Overall, I genuinely believe Bangladeshis are very secular-minded overall. Even today, despite all these crackdowns, so one has to wait and watch. And it also depends on the response of the government and whether they are able to actually apprehend some of these criminals and bring them to trial.
Okay. Seshadri, you're talking about intelligence sharing, but let me ask you a slightly different question. Why has India officially taken up with Dhaka the recent threat to a Hindu priest of Ramakrishna Mission in Bangladesh? Is this priest an Indian citizen and therefore we are concerned about him because he's an Indian, or is he a Bangladeshi Hindu?
No, that's one of the reasons that he is an Indian, and he is, I think he settled there for a long time, and then he was doing very good social activities.
He's an Indian citizen.
Also.
Yes, usually.
Yeah. Usually Ramakrishna Mission sends people head. And then they settle there and then develop and all that.
Indians, okay. But so, majority
of Bangladesh. But more importantly, I think it's not just a question, India is too much in stake as far as Bangladesh is concerned. Our economic engagement with Bangladesh and Southeast Asia is also very important.
Absolutely.
Any economic development of Northeast of India and the Southeast Asia will be incomplete without the link that Bangladesh provides.
Absolutely.
And then if Bangladesh is under a spell of Islamic radicalism, it hurts not just India, because anything that happens in Bangladesh, the spillover is immediately...
Okay, let me ask the spillover question to Pinak. Pinak, what kind of spillover impact could the growth of Islamic extremism have in India? That is, the growth in Bangladesh impacting India, especially the adjoining states of West Bengal and Assam.
We've already seen one happening in Burdwan, if you remember. The JMB people had fled Bangladesh and taken refuge there, and they some bombs blew up, etc. That could happen again. And let's not forget, there are lots of Bangladeshi migrants in all these districts. And there are madrasas, mosques, etc., that have come up. And some of them, can be subverted and used as bases exactly for this kind of activities against Bangladesh and sometimes within India. So, we are so close to each other in terms of our populations, ethnicities, etc., and the long border. It is entirely, I think, conceivable that if Islamic extremism and radicalism grows in Bangladesh, it will have a spillover effect, at least in the neighboring districts.
Master Mitter, if there's a large-scale influx of Hindu minorities from Bangladesh, for example, I know they've been coming in drips and drabs, but if there's a large-scale influx, what kind of nightmare would that be for India?
No, naturally, absorbing such a large community will create a problem economically and all that. But just to go back one little bit on what the earlier question, there could be a game plan to actually sort of encourage retaliatory strikes against Muslims in India, you know, to create a sort of communally charged atmosphere. So that could be also a danger, particularly in the border areas where there are large Muslim communities. So one has to keep an eye on that possibility also.
And if there's an influx? Because, you know, I mean, the current ruling dispensation in India has said that if Hindus are being persecuted anywhere, they are most welcome and they'll be given citizenship. But there's an economic cost to all this.
Yes, there is. But then you have to bear that economic cost and absorb the people and rehabilitate them, give them jobs.
Why should India take refugees from Bangladesh and, in fact, encourage them by saying that you're welcome here? Let them go to Myanmar, let them go to Sri Lanka, let them go elsewhere.
No, I think the sentimental attachment between the Hindus in Bangladesh and India is there. It is an accepted fact. You cannot run away from that.
Okay, all right.
No, to extend it further, if there is a persecution even in other countries other than Bangladesh, India is the only refuge. So you cannot just dismiss it off as something. But how to handle that issue? From New Delhi.
You know, I would have no problems if India was welcoming refugees of all hues.
But what happens to the persecution of Hindus in Pakistan? That's a different subject. We are not discussing it now. But of course, wherever it's a question of your sentimental attachment, and you have a huge people of Indian origin community all over the world. You call them PIO. So the Hindus in Bangladesh are no less a PIO than anybody else, or in Suriname or Fiji or some other country.
India has not signed the UN Refugee Convention. There are Rohingya refugees here. There are refugees of all kind here.
Absolutely.
Our approach to them should be the same that we have towards refugees who come from Pakistan or Bangladesh.
It's ironical. The West is concerned about 200 and 300 Syrian refugees, whereas we have got millions of refugees from unknown countries in the world.
Okay, but
we're
not discussing refugees today. Let me ask you this.
Consideration which no government can dismiss.
Let me bring it back to Bangladesh. I'll come to you in a bit. Could the growth of Islamic radicalism in Bangladesh excite Muslim radicals in India and in turn Hindu radicals to respond, as Ambassador Mitra says?
No, I don't think it will span off to such an extent. As if, I mean, a sort of a communal war between Hindu-Muslim. I don't see such a situation at all. But yes, there could be incidents in the border areas. There could be some political formulations on both sides of the fence to take a little bit of advantage of it. But I don't think it will go into a large-scale issue.
Yeah.
But yes, the economic aspect of all these things could be a very large one, especially if you have to accommodate a few 100,000 Hindus in, say, West Bengal or Assam, it could create a problem. And then these issues can have a local effect.
Okay.
But I don't think it will be an all-India effect.
Pinaki, you wanted to say something?
No, I simply wanted to say that when you look at the migration of any community from Bangladesh, there are obviously different aspects. The Hindus have been migrating. There is a whole history. There's a pattern. Also, the Muslims have been migrating, but the reasons are different. That is the moot point.
Yeah.
The economic the Muslims are mainly coming for economic reasons. Why would they come otherwise?
Yeah.
There is no reason. The Hindus come for other reasons.
Okay, let me ask you a general question now, because we're ending this thing. We've run out of time. What should Sheikh Hasina government be doing, which it is not doing, to curb religious extremism in that country?
No.
I mean, these mass arrests are fine, but, you know, they don't. They have not curbed any violence.
No, as I said earlier, the current pattern of individual targeting is much more difficult to handle. And it requires a lot of intelligence to beef up the whole intelligence apparatus. And I should hope that we can play a role in just assisting in intelligence sharing and things like that. It's much tougher than just going after these sort of people who are engaging in random terrorism.
But you still see it as a law and order and intelligence gathering issue. You don't see it as a issue that can be tackled politically by Bangladesh as a whole.
At the moment, I still think it's not such a big issue that you know, everything has gone out of control. Even the last Durga Puja was celebrated in a very big way in Bangladesh. Under Hasina government, the number of pujas that are held have grown phenomenally. I have personally been to them, and there's been no problem. So you shouldn't jump to the conclusion that all minorities are now in dire threat and things like that. Basic secular structure remains true.
Yeah, that's not the issue. But I think India should increase its engagement with the present government in Bangladesh, and also try to impress upon the present dispensation that the present government has to build a political consensus on these issues. Otherwise, the secular character of Bangladesh, if it is lost, that will be a very great loss to a huge cultural base that India has on the eastern side of its border. So I think it should be very difficult.
Good. So we end on this happy note that Bangladesh should maintain its secularism and remain a secular country. We have run out of time. I would like to thank all of you. Mr. Seshadri Chari, Ambassador Rajeet Mittal, Ambassador Pinak Ranjan Chakravarty, thank you for participating in this discussion. That is all we have for you today. We'll be back again as usual next week. Till then, goodbye, and thanks for watching India's World.